All right. So, eighth graders, do any of you remember this presentation? Richard, nice. And William, okay. So, this might be slightly boring for you, at least the first part, because it's kind of the same. But I added some new pictures, and that's going to be really exciting, I think. Just kidding. Just medium exciting, I think. So, all right. Oh, also, this presentation is about Mr. B. But then I realized, like, hey, I should probably also talk about science instead of just talking about myself, because that would be lame if I just talked about myself. So, I am from Phoenix, Arizona. Has anyone here ever been to Arizona before? What did you guys think about Arizona? You liked it? What's your name again? Layla. Layla, Gabe's sister. Okay.
I haven't been there that much. I usually just go there so I can go on to another flight to go see
Okay, so you went to the airport. Like,
dad. But it looks nice.
it is nice, yeah. Like 75% of the people I've talked to have just been to the airport. They don't haven't even gone outside the airport. Anyone else like been outside and seen some of the stuff in Arizona? Mason.
The cactuses are pretty cool.
Yes, the cactuses. So if you look right here, where I'm pointing my mouse, these are called saguaro cactuses. And have any of you guys seen like cartoons with these type of cactuses and stuff like that? Yeah, so like one of my kids in my advisory class over there said, "Oh, look, it's the cartoon cactuses." So these cactuses are like famous because they're kind of, I don't know, they're weird looking or something. But when I was growing up in Arizona, they were just normal. Like we have one of these in our backyard. Like when you drive down the street, they're just kind of all over the place. But they're kind of cool. Like they're very big, and you see these little holes right here. You guys know what those holes are? Any guesses? Nests, yep. So is that what you were gonna say, Mason? Yeah. So there are these birds called cactus wrens. It's actually the state bird of Arizona, and they go and they pick holes in the cactus, and they pick these little like nests, and they kind of go all in the cactus. And then the cactus forms like this like bark on the inside, like a little like scab or something. So it's like a little nest, and then the birds live in there. And then when the cactus dies, you can find these little like the bark of the cactus that's like the shape of the nest and stuff. So the cactus it's like a whole ecosystem. There's lots of different animals that live in there. It's pretty sweet. So you guys, any guesses as to who this is? Yeah. I think I was about your age, maybe a little younger. Wait, do we have mostly seventh graders in here? Who's a seventh grader? Raise your hand. Oh yeah, okay. We're mostly seventh graders. Nice. Are you guys excited to be in the real middle school now instead of in the modulars? Yeah. Were the modulars kind of lame? It was okay, but you were alone. That's kind of what I'm hearing. Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of weird, I guess, being out. But maybe you feel a little special because like you're your own thing. You're not really elementary school. You're not really middle school. But now you're officially middle school. Anyways, so yep, just kind of a normal kid. I think I was actually playing video games in this picture, which is why I'm staring very intently over here. But anyways. So I was raised in Phoenix, Arizona. I went to Cactus Shadows High School, and I ran track and cross country. Do any of you run track in here? All right. Yeah, I know some of you do because I coached for like 5 days last year before the pandemic shut us down. Cross country. Does anyone know what cross country is? So cross country is sort of like track, but it's only the distance events. So you only run long distances. And then instead of running around a track a bunch of times, you actually go and run on trails and stuff like that. So in Arizona, a lot of times they have lots of golf courses because it doesn't snow in Arizona very often. So a lot of times we would have our cross country races on golf courses. So this is me running in a cross country race right there. And so when I was growing up, I really liked running track and cross country. And I also did lots of outdoorsy stuff like camping with my family and all that. So yeah, any other questions about Arizona? Yes, William.
Was it, were you able to go far off, like explore?
Explore, yeah. So probably the coolest thing that's in Arizona is the Grand Canyon. Has anyone here been to the Grand Canyon? Oh, that's too bad. The Grand Canyon is super, super cool. I'll just pull up a picture really fast. Why not? Grand Canyon. If I can spell it right. Yeah, so that's a picture of the Grand Canyon. So Arizona is really, really dry, and it's kind of the ground is kind of sandy. And so when water, like a river, flows over the ground for a long time, it cuts these really, really deep canyons. It's kind of the same in like southern Utah. And so the Grand Canyon's just the biggest one of all of them. Hello. Anyways, so when I was young, we went on, I think I was a fifth grader, and the school organized like a trip. Like everyone that was graduating fifth grade got to go on this trip to the Grand Canyon. And so I got to go with my dad, and I think we just like camped in tents or something. I don't really remember how we did it, but I remember like I'd never seen anything like the Grand Canyon before. It's like a 2-hour drive from my house. And so, yeah, we got to explore in Arizona, which was pretty cool. So Arizona is kind of dry and desolate, but there's lots of cool stuff there too. Okay, any other questions, or shall we move on? Yep, there we go. Okay. All right, so after that, I went to college, and I went to this place right here, which is the University of Arizona. It's in Tucson. Tucson's a cool town. It's down pretty far south, close to the border with Mexico, and it's pretty hot and dry, and I like going there, but I kind of felt like transferring after my freshman year, so I eventually transferred to a school called BYU, and BYU is in Utah. Has anyone here ever been to Utah before? Nice. Where did you guys go in Utah? Can't remember. Okay. Bet you did go. That's cool. Do you know where you went? To where? Sandy. Okay. Do you have family there? Nice. Yeah, Sandy is in Salt Lake, so that's maybe about half an hour north of this. This is Provo, that's the name of the town where this is. Utah is cool because they have these really big mountains super close to the school, and there's lots of snowing, or not snowing, there's lots of snow, and it snows during the winter, so there's skiing and stuff like that. Yeah, and that was really fascinating to me as an Arizona person. I had never really lived in a place with snow before. So when I was at BYU, I did triathlon. Who knows what triathlon is? Aaron? So I did the triathlon club, and triathlon is a race where you start off by swimming, usually in a lake. You do a really big, long swim out in the lake, and then you swim back. And then you ride your bike. Usually the races we did, I rode my bike for about 25 miles. And then afterwards, you do a run, and the races I did, usually it was like a 6-mile run. So it was a combination of those three sports. And when I was doing that, I met a lady right here. Any guesses as to who this lady is for my eighth graders? Mrs. Bagnall, that's right. So I met a girl who also did triathlons, and we eventually got married. And now she teaches at the high school. So she teaches math over just at Wilder High School, right there. So when I was at BYU, I studied entrepreneurship and science. Does anyone know what entrepreneurship is? No? So entrepreneurship is when people start new businesses. So maybe you have an idea, you're like, hey, I have an idea for these really cool shoes or something, and I want to make these cool shoes because I think people will buy them. So you go talk to people, and maybe you get someone to give you money to start the business. Then you find a factory to make the shoes, and then you start making the shoes, and you start selling them. That's entrepreneurship. And entrepreneurship is cool. So if anyone has questions or things, ideas about entrepreneurship, I'm always happy to talk to students about that kind of stuff. And another thing I want to emphasize is that do your teachers always tell you to go to college? Yeah, why do they tell you that?
To get a good job.
Get a good job, okay. Any other reasons why your teachers tell you that? Why do you think they tell you that? guys are so quiet. I'm just trying to think of any question that's going to get you talking. It's really, it's okay. It's probably better than if you were all crazy, right? Like if it was the opposite, that would be really hard too. So one of the biggest reasons is to get a good job. College does lots of good things. I gave a little presentation about education to, was it only to our advisory class? Did I give you guys that presentation? I think it was only to our, you remember that, Richard, last year? So you can get a really good job, but there's also lots of other good things that happen, like you're less likely to smoke when you grow up, you have better health and stuff like that. There's lots of like kind of boring reasons to go to college, but another reason to go to college is that college is really, really fun. So this is a bunch of my triathlon friends from college. And like every weekend we would go on these cool adventures. Like this is in Zions National Park. Has anyone ever heard of Zions National Park before? So it's in southern Utah, and it's this place with these crazy big canyons and red rocks and stuff. So we would go hang out like that. We would it was just really fun to meet other people about your age who are doing similar stuff to you. So not only is college really good for you because it'll help you get a good job and education is good for you, but college is also really fun. So I encourage everyone to go to college. Okay, any questions about college or any of this stuff? Not so much? All right. After college, I worked for a small company that was run by an entrepreneur. So he was just starting a new company. But they had a lot of problems. They made some bad business decisions, and so the company ran out of money eventually. I married Mrs. Bagnell. This is Mrs. Bagnell right here, and also right here. After this company ran out of money, me and Mrs. Bagnell both were ski instructors. So this is in Utah. You can see the snow all over the place back here. And then instead of triathlons, I started doing ultramarathons. You guys know what ultramarathons are? Yeah? Richard? Yes, William, do you remember?
Yeah, like a huge marathon.
Yeah, it's like a really, really long race. So who knows how long a marathon is? A marathon is 26.2 miles. So 26-mile running race. So ultramarathons are anything that's a running race that's farther than 26.2 miles. So I did a 50K, which is 31 miles, a couple of years ago. And then last year I did a 50-mile race. So that was just near Boise where I did that. And then obviously after all that, I started teaching because I'm teaching now. And these are some of my teacher friends that are in this area. She teaches at Nampa High. She teaches in Payette, I'm pretty sure. Either Payette or Weezer, I can never remember. Keep those two straight. And then she teaches in New Plymouth. So got a bunch of teacher friends. And then here I have this cool mustache. What do you guys think about that? Cool or not cool? Okay, we got a not cool over here. Any votes for cool? Oh, we got two. Okay, three for cool. Four for cool. Five for cool. Oh, I'm impressed. How about votes for not cool? I think everyone's just afraid to say it's not cool, even though most people think it's not cool. Is that right? Yeah, I can't really tell. Anyways, I don't have a mustache anymore. All right. So, well, this is weird. You guys see that? How it's, you can kind of see the old page there. I wonder where that is. Anyways, now we live in Idaho, and Idaho is awesome. One of the things I like to do in Idaho is go fishing. Does anyone here go fishing? Ooh, we got some enthusiastic hands. Nice. What do you guys like to fish for? Catching catfishes. Do you fish for catfish in the Snake River?
Yeah, we used to do that because like once you started,
there's times you've never caught them. Is that what you said? Oh, really? Oh, wow. Yeah, me and my friend tried to go catfishing once, and we didn't catch anything, and I got literally, I think, 100 mosquito bites. I counted. It was terrible. So I haven't had any luck with that. Yes?
Rainbow trout.
Rainbow trout. Okay, do you know what this is right here? Can you see it? It's a rainbow trout. So I also like to catch rainbow trout. Nice. What do you like to fish for? Salmon. Where do you go for that? Can't remember. Yeah. Yeah, so, oh, yeah, Mason?
Sometimes fish bass.
Bass? Where do you fish for bass?
My brother's pond.
Oh, do they own, like, a private pond?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the fancy kind of fishing where you can catch lots of fish. Actually, one of my teacher friends, so one of these people, but she's not in this picture, her dad was, like, a senator or something in Idaho. He's, like, a famous guy or something. And he owns a fishing pond that's stocked with rainbow trout. But I've never fished there, but maybe one day. Anyways, yeah, this is me fishing on the Boise River near Star. Has anyone been to Star before? Star, Idaho? Yeah, I got a couple. Nice little town. And I caught this little rainbow trout near in Boise, like on the same river, but actually in town. So fishing, pretty fun. This is me and Mrs. B hiking in the Owyhees. Do you guys know where the Owyhees are?
I've heard of it, but I've heard that
it's beautiful, but I don't do it. Yeah. Oh, really? Do you catch them?
Sometimes, but my sister, she's always been confused by them, and she's always scared of them. I never catch them because they're scary.
Yeah, that's funny. William, what's your comment on the
Owyhees? I think me and our dad, I think we go there normally.
To catch what kind of fish?
A crappie.
Oh, crappie. Okay. Wait, where in the Owyhees do you go for that?
I'm not sure, but it's like somewhere where a dam is.
Oh, okay. Huh. Maybe I'll have to go check that out. Okay, two more Owyhee comments.
My dad went fishing around for July. Now we go through everything.
Oh, cool. Sweet.
We go there.
Yeah. Ah, yes. So, yeah, this road, you can kind of see it right here. We were just, like, hiking and running on it, but there's a lot of people that were riding ATVs and stuff. So there's lots of, like, ATV and Jeep riding there. So, yeah, the Owyhees are the mountains. You can actually sort of see them through the gap in the trees. They're just south of here. It's kind of cool because most of the place around here is, like, a desert, but then the Owyhees go up and it's, like, pine trees, like, just high up in the middle of the desert, which is kind of cool. This right here, this is in the middle of my ultramarathon last year. Yeah, so it started in Boise, went up to Bogus Basin, the ski resort, then came back down, and it was 50 miles long. This was at mile like 40 or something, so I was tired in this picture. You can't really tell, but I was very tired. Yeah, so that's Mr. B. Any questions about Mr. B, about Mrs. B, about fishing?
Have you ever tried fly fishing?
Yeah, so in this picture right here, I'm actually fly fishing. Yeah. Yes, I did. So there's a specific type of, not that you all need to know this, but I'm going to tell you anyways. There's a specific type of fly fishing called Euro nymphing, where you put the little flies on your line, and then you put some weight on it, and then instead of like, normally fly fishing, it's like a bug floating on the surface, but Euro nymphing, you hold your rod and then you let the flies like sink in the water and then it just kind of flows and you just kind of go with the flow of the water with your rod like this. You actually catch a ton of fish. It's really, really easy to catch fish like that. So, yeah. And you can even Euro nymph with a normal fishing rod if you just learn how to rig it up properly. But yeah, fly fishing is fun. Cool. All right. So if there's no other questions, we're going to move on to learning about science class. All right. So who likes science here? Ooh, this is pretty good. This is like 75% of the class. All right. Why do you guys like science? What's enjoyable about it, I guess?
It's like you get to do more
projects. Yeah, instead of maybe for other classes you're just doing problems or writing or whatever, but science is a little bit more project-based. It's true.
The fact that you learn new things and how things work is always interesting. And for me, in my opinion, I don't know about anyone else, but it's very exciting learning new things about your body or something else.
Yeah, I agree. And people who are the most successful in life are usually the ones who like to learn new things, and they're always trying to learn new things all the time. So that's a great thing that you said, William. Yeah, science is awesome, and science is very powerful because science, when humans can understand science and apply it to the right situations, humans can do almost anything. We're going to be talking a little bit about that this year. But this year, we're studying physical science, okay? And physical science is comprised of two kind of separate fields of science, and that's chemistry and physics. Does anyone know what the word chemistry means, or what chemistry is? Any guesses? So you haven't studied any chemistry before this, have you? This is your first time with chemistry? Is that right? Okay, it looks like that's the case for most people. Sweet. So chemistry is the study of chemicals and how they interact with each other. Okay, does anyone know what a chemical is? So you don't know how to explain it? All right. Any guesses? This is sort of a trick question, but I'm going to let you try anyways. Uh-huh. Yeah, so what's your name again?
Bell.
Bell, saying that you take two chemicals and put them together to make a reaction. That's true. Chemical reactions is an important thing that we're going to study this year. So chemicals are, like I said, it's a bit of a trick question because chemicals are actually everything. This cabinet is made of chemicals. Kenya's desk is made of chemicals. Richard's iPad has a ton of different chemicals in it. And even more importantly, our bodies are entirely chemicals. Chemicals is just a different name for matter. And matter is kind of anything that you can touch or feel. So even air is matter. You can't really feel it if you're just kind of standing there, but you can, if there's wind or something, you can feel the air. That's matter. So chemistry specifically is the study of how matter interacts with other types of matter, right? So one way they can interact is if you have two chemicals that want to form a bond or that interact in a certain way, it can form a chemical reaction. Chemical reactions are really important because our body is really just one huge, giant, really complicated chemical reaction that's always happening. Each one of our cells, you guys have all studied cells before, right? Each one of our cells has tons and tons of little tiny chemical reactions that have to happen all the time so that they can keep running. And our body is made of like trillions of cells. So we're basically just one giant chemical reaction. And we can, if you study the body enough, you can actually learn how to influence those chemical reactions in certain ways. So for instance, let's say I have a really bad headache and I want to get my headache away. What's a way I can get my headache to go away? Any ideas? What do you guys do if you have a headache usually?
Go back to sleep.
Go back to sleep, okay. Medicine, okay. So let's just focus on those two things. So if you go back to sleep, you're letting your body... Sleeping is a process that your body goes through in order to remove certain chemicals from your brain that build up when you're awake. So if you've been awake for a long time, you get really tired. That's because certain chemicals build up in your brain, and your brain needs to take a break to allow it to clear those out. So maybe if you have a headache, it's because you didn't get enough sleep. And so taking a nap might take some of those chemicals out, let it function better. Medicine's an even better example. So let's say you have a migraine or something. There's scientists that spent a ton of time studying migraines and how they work and what we can do to get rid of them, and they develop chemicals called drugs or medicine, and you put those in your body, and it goes into your brain, and it actually changes the physiology, the chemistry of your brain, and so your headache goes away. So think about all the things we can do with chemicals. It's amazing what we can do with them. And we're just, as a species, sort of scratching the surface. Like, we just are barely starting to understand all the different things we can do with chemicals. So we need lots of really smart people, like all of you, to grow up and become scientists and discover new chemicals and new things that we can do to help our bodies and other things, right? Okay, so that's chemistry. It's the study of the way that matter interacts. Anyone know what physics is? I know we've had some students study physics before. Hey, Isaac.
How's it going?
So, physics. Does anyone know what physics means?
Like gravity.
Gravity is a part of physics. That's right. It's a good. That is a important part of physics.
Understanding.
Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of profound, actually. It is understanding. And specifically what physics is, it's the study and the understanding of the way that matter moves. So, for instance, if I take my cell phone right here and I push it with, let's say, like 10 newtons of force in this direction, and then I let go of it, what's going to happen? It could break, that's true. It's going to fly. So if you study physics enough, you're going to know if I push it in this direction with that much force, exactly where it's going to go. You could like draw an X on the floor, it would land exactly there, and so you can study the exact way that it moves through the air. So why do you think this might be useful for humans? William?
So that when someone does a prank on you and throws your phone in the pool, you can catch it and save it.
Yeah, that's true. You would know, well, like in a sense, people who play sports are sort of physicists, right? Because they have to look at the way a ball is flying through the air and say, okay, because the ball is flying at that speed in this direction, I know that if I put my hand out here, I'll be able to catch it or something like that. You know what I mean? Well, there's lots of reasons why physics is important, and we're going to talk about some of those when we talk about these pictures. So some of the things we're going to study in physics are Newtonian mechanics. Isaac Newton was a really old guy. I think he was alive in like the 1500s, if I remember correctly. And he came up with these laws that describe how objects move through the air. So he was the one who said, okay, if you push on an object with this much force, it's going to go in that direction. And he was kind of the one that thought of those laws first. So we're going to study how those laws work. We're going to study energy. So energy is important for getting work done. Like if you put gas in your car, you turn your car on and drive around, you have to understand how energy works in order to understand how your car works, right? Waves. Waves are like a pattern of movement. So you can think of waves on a beach, how they come like in regular intervals, and they're about the same size, right? Waves actually describe lots of different things in physics, like
airwaves.
Yeah, so one air wave you're probably thinking of is like radio waves. So when you turn your car on and you listen to the radio when you're driving around, your car gets that information from the radio from big towers that emit certain electromagnetic waves. And so these waves go all over the country. If you have an antenna, you can pick up those waves and listen to the radio, which is kind of cool. We got a big class walking by. It's kind of distracting. Oh, hey, that's a Star. Yeah, and Jasmine. Sweet. Another type of physics we're going to study is heat. So heat is actually it's how much energy individual atoms and molecules have. And atoms and molecules, actually, they don't stand perfectly still. They vibrate, and that vibration is the heat that they have. So if atoms and molecules are totally still, it means they're completely frozen. But if they vibrate, that means they have a certain amount of heat. The more heat, the more they vibrate. We'll talk more about this later. We don't need to go into details. So suffice it to say, there's lots of really interesting things that you can study with physics and chemistry. And they're really, really important for us to make our lives better and also to kind of explore and discover new things. So let's talk about some of this more interesting stuff here. Does anyone know what this thing is right here? These two are actually the same thing, just different perspectives. Belle?
A satellite?
Satellite. Not quite, but close. Also used for scientific discovery. Mason?
A laser?
It's close to a laser. So this is something called the Large Hadron Collider. Has anyone heard of that before? Yeah, I actually had one kid who sort of recognized it, which I was really impressed by. Anyways, So this this is a giant machine, and it's actually the biggest machine in the world. It's the biggest machine that's ever been built. So if we look at this picture, this is an outline of the Large Hadron Collider, this little circle here. Does anyone know what this thing is? I don't know if you can see that very well. Any guesses as to what that is? No. So these are like houses right here. What does this kind of look like to you guys? Any guesses? If you can't think of it, that's fine. This is actually an airport. So this is where planes land. So the airport is tiny compared to that Large Hadron Collider. It's like you could fit like 10 of these airports inside of just the circle made by the Large Hadron Collider. So the Large Hadron Collider, what it is it takes little tiny atoms. You guys all know what atoms are, right? So it's the smallest piece of, essentially the smallest piece of matter that we can use to build big things. So Kenya's desk is made up of trillions and trillions and trillions of little tiny atoms all stuck together. Physicists, they did lots of studying and learning about matter, and eventually they realized, hey, atoms are actually built up of a bunch of little tiny, even smaller particles. And they're like, we want to study what those smaller particles are. And they realized that if you took an atom and if you accelerated it to almost the speed of light, so super, super, super fast, like faster than you can even imagine, and smash it into another atom, those atoms would explode and these particles would go flying all over the place. So what this machine does is it takes a little tiny atom and it starts shooting it around the circle, and then it speeds it up to about the speed of light, so super, super fast going around the circle, and then it smashes it into another atom. And then scientists can study. They have a little machine that reads what happens after the atoms smash together. And they can study the little tiny particles that kind of spray out all over the place. So this machine, the biggest machine in the world, was built to study the smallest things that we even know that exist, and these little tiny subatomic particles. And scientists have learned lots of really interesting things about how the universe was formed and like the nature of reality and all this really kind of crazy deep philosophical stuff because of this big machine. So if you all really were like, man, I really like physics, this is really cool, I want to study more about it, you could go to college and study more about particle physics, and when you grow up you could work at the Large Hadron Collider and discover these little tiny particles and stuff. That's kind of cool, right? Okay, anyone know specifically what this is? Well, I'll have you. Anyone know what this is? Yeah. Spacecraft, okay. Does anyone know what spacecraft it is? This is for bonus points if you know what spacecraft it is. I would be surprised if you did. Yes, let me check. Oh, we have someone from the science classroom is out, so. I'll keep an eye on them, Richard, and then see if you can go. Okay, so this spacecraft is called the Starship, okay, and it's built by a company called SpaceX, and we're going to talk a little bit about SpaceX today in this video. And SpaceX is an interesting company because most spaceships are built by governments, like the Chinese government will make a spaceship, or the U.S. government through NASA will make spaceships and they'll send them up and they'll launch satellites and explore the moon and stuff. But this one was built by a private company by a really rich guy named Elon Musk. Have you guys heard of Elon Musk before? Yeah, we got some people saying yes. He's kind of like a meme. I feel like he's always in memes. You know what I'm talking about? Anyways, Elon Musk is basically Tony Stark from the Avengers. Like, he's this really rich kind of crazy guy and he builds these really insane technologies. In fact, just recently he built this thing called Neuralink. Have you guys heard of that before? So it's a chip that you implant into your brain, and it allows you to kind of hook up with computers so you can send information to the computers way faster than like typing, right? So just like last week, they showed these pigs that they had implanted the chip into their brain. And the chips were supposed to, the ones they're developing now are supposed to help with like chronic conditions like migraines or something. So like maybe like 10 years from now, if you have really bad migraines, you can go and they'll put a chip in your brain and then it'll get rid of the migraines. So it's kind of cool, right? You're like half a robot or something, you know? Does that sound exciting to people or kind of scary?
Scary.
Yeah. It is a little scary too, right? Because it's like, at what point do we become like half robots, or are we fully human? Like, what does that mean? You know, but it's pretty interesting nonetheless. Anyways, Elon Musk, he founded this company. He started this company, and his goal, and the goal of the people who work at this company, is that they want to be the first to have humans live on Mars. Okay, you guys know Mars, the planet, right? So they're building this specific ship right here because they want to make a ship that will be able to take humans all the way to Mars. Mars is really far away. It's a lot farther away than the moon. And so the journey is like 6 months long or something. So this ship, you can't really see it in this picture, but it's like the size of like a skyscraper. It's like huge. And especially this engine down here, it just goes way up in the air. And so it's this really, really complex technical problem of how do we get the ship to fly to Mars? How do we aim it in the right place to know where Mars is? How do we land it? How do we develop a spaceship that will then be able to fly back? It's all this crazy stuff. But the awesome thing is, like, no human has ever been to another planet. This is like huge. This is like one of the most important things that has ever happened in the history of our species is going to another planet, right? And because we have people that studied physics, we are really close to making that happen. Like, they're building a prototype of the ship today in Texas. And you, as the bright young minds of America, let's say you really like physics and you go on to study physics in school, you could go work for SpaceX and be one of the scientists that builds this ship that sends people to Mars, or even an astronaut that goes to Mars, right? That's all a possibility for you, and it's close to happening because we have the technology now. Another thing, any questions about that spaceship before we talk about this last thing? As I've already mentioned, chemistry and physics is super important for medicine as well. So with coronavirus, we're going to be doing some stuff with coronavirus this year for our challenges. It's really important that we understand the chemistry of how viruses work. There's physics that happens in our bodies too, like our heart has to pump at a certain pressure to get the blood to move all throughout our body. If the valves in our heart are partially blocked, it's going to have to pump harder to get the same amount of blood out. So how do we calculate the physics of that? There's all sorts of interesting stuff that happens with chemistry and physics that is super important to humans. Okay. All right. We're about to watch a video. Any questions before we go to the video? Yes. Yes, that's probably what I was talking about. I don't know if anyone thinks that we'll be able to live forever, but I do know that they think some conditions that can affect your brain, especially when you get older, like dementia. Have you heard of dementia before? Dementia is where you start like forgetting where you are and you can't remember anything. And sometimes we have older relatives that have dementia, like my grandpa had dementia when he got really old. But those chips might be able to combat some of the symptoms of dementia, so make us live longer than we currently can. Okay, so this video is a video by this same company that is making this rocket chip. And one of the cool things that they did is previously when there was rocket chips, let's see what time it is, the rocket chips would have to shoot up into the sky, and then they'd like put the satellite in orbit or whatever they were going to do, and then the entire rocket ship would just go down to Earth and it would just burn up in Earth's atmosphere. So like they would spend like hundreds of millions of dollars making these really expensive rocket ships, and then they would just destroy the rocket ship every time they launched it into space. That seems a little wasteful, right? It's like, it'd be like if you took your car to the grocery store, and then when you got to the grocery store, you just blew up your car. And then you had to buy a new car to drive back to your house. That doesn't seem like a very wise use of money, right? So this company, they decided, hey, we got to find a way to reuse these rockets. We got to find a way to shoot the rockets up and then land them back down without exploding them. because that's going to make it way cheaper when we want to go into space. So, this video is going to be one of the first times that they actually successfully landed a rocket from shooting it up into space. And they also, they like to be funny, this company. So they also took a sports car and they put a dummy in an astronaut chute. And so this is just testing their rocket. So they shoot the rocket up just to see if they can make it land. But just to be funny, they also launch the space car out into space. Like the space car is like driving away. So let's hope this video works because sometimes YouTube has problems. Oh, yes, sweet. Okay. There's the car they're going to shoot into space. Notice they tried to land that rocket on a ship, but they missed and they exploded the whole rocket. So they made a bunch of mistakes too. All right, so pretty cool. They landed the rockets, right? What did you guys think about that video? Yeah, what was cool about it? So when the rocket was launching, yeah. So it takes a ton of force to get because it's a huge. You saw it coming out of the hangar where they keep it. Like humans are tiny, tiny, tiny compared to those things. So. Takes a ton of force to lift it off. So yeah, it has to shoot out tons of flames and stuff. What was that? Sorry?
It's heavy.
Yeah, it's really, really heavy. Super cool when they were able to land the rockets back down. It looks like a science fiction movie or something. And also interesting, like, they're this fancy company and they have really, really smart scientists, like really smart people, but they still make mistakes. Like, they totally didn't even hit the ship they were trying to land that other rocket on just completely missed and exploded in the ocean. So that was kind of interesting too. Anyways, like I said, if you study physics enough, you will be able to do stuff like that when you grow up, which is pretty cool. Okay. So what time is it? Okay. So here's the thing. Mr. B has to go at 10 to a meeting with Mr. Dillon. So I'm going to go really fast through this stuff, and if you have questions, just let me know. Because I want to get you started on your project so that when I'm gone, you'll have something to do instead of just sitting here bored, right? So this year, we are going to be studying chemistry and physics, like I said. We're going to be doing a challenge that we're going to introduce to you guys on Wednesday. It's probably going to be about coronavirus and about how we can keep Wilder safe. And so some of our science we'll be learning about in the context of that. And you guys are going to actually come up with a solution. How are we going to keep Wilder safe from coronavirus? And you're going to put it into place. Like you're going to talk to City Hall or you're going to talk to Mr. Dillon, whatever you guys decide. is the best way to make it safe. You guys are the ones in charge. So that's going to be kind of cool. We're also going to be doing projects a little bit similar to last year, just because we won't be able to cover everything in the challenge. And I want to also have the option open to do Edgenuity, because some people prefer Edgenuity to projects. What do you guys prefer, projects or Edgenuity? Edgenuity. Do you all prefer Edgenuity? Okay, so all three of these students prefer Edgenuity. It can be a little more straightforward. You know exactly what you need to do. So, Edgenuity, I didn't explain what it is. It's basically online school. So you watch videos about a topic in physics, and then you can take notes, and then you take little quizzes about those videos and those, and you can use your notes and stuff. So that's an easy way to do it. We're also going to, okay, so how we're going to keep kids on task, or not on task, but on pace. Last year, a lot of people got kind of behind pace, and then I started doing this thing where I would say, if you haven't finished this project by a certain date, you're going to have to come sit at my table with me. And so it's like sitting with Mr. B. Did you guys like to sit with Mr. B last year? Nope. People didn't like it because then they couldn't sit with their friends. They had to sit with me and work really hard. But that is a good incentive to finish your projects on time. So I'm going to try to give you due dates, and then after the due date, I'm going to give you like a, if you haven't finished by this time, you have to sit with Mr. B. To keep people on task, sometimes when kids get really loud, I would do this thing called quiet time, where I would say, okay, we have to be silent for 2 minutes or whatever time that I decided. And if anyone talked during that time, I would restart the timer, and we would have to start all over again on the time. And that worked pretty well with keeping kids quiet. This year so far, most of the time, kids have been quiet anyways, maybe because we're spread apart more. But we might do quiet time if we need to. Yeah. And then you guys already know how to do the bathroom and then lunch and breaks, right? Because you've done that with your other teachers a bunch of times already, so you understand that. I think that's my whole presentation, is it? Yep. So, I'm going to stop this recording.